EAA's webinars are made possible through the generous support of Aircraft Spruce and Specialty, serving home builders and EAA members since 1965.
Tonight's presentation is titled, What's Changed and What Hasn't? Our presenter is Mike Bush. Mike is president for Savvy Aviation Incorporated. He's a author for numerous aviation publications. Mike holds a certified flight instructor certificate, A&P mechanic certificate with inspection authorization, 2018 FAA Aviation Maintenance Technician of the Year, and a member of EAA, continuing his volunteering and presenting these webinars for us. Mike's been with us since the very start on these webinars, so we're so thankful, Mike. You're with us tonight. I'm going to turn control of the presentation over to you.
Good evening, Tim. Evening, everybody. Tim, I was actually National AMT of the Year for 2008, not 2018, but that's okay.
My bad. Thank you.
If you want to give it to me again, that's good. Let me see if I can bring my screen up here. I get my usual thing. Are you seeing my screen okay?
I see your screen great, Mike. Yep.
Okay. They must have changed the software because it's a little different of what came up. the subject for tonight, it's titled What's Changed and What Hasn't? And I want to take a look back over the past 50 years. Those of you who have attended my webinars recently or attended any of my talks at AirVenture this year, you know that I just recently completed writing a new book on engines. And in the course of putting together that book, it was kind of like a trip down memory lane through everything I'd written over the past 30 years on the subject. And I couldn't help but reflect on how much has changed in the past 50 years since I bought my first airplane. I bought my first airplane in 1968, so it's a 50th anniversary, and how much has stayed the same. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that. I wrote about that in the epilogue of the book, and I'm sort of basing this tonight's webinar on the thoughts that I had when I was writing that epilogue. For the most part, our engines haven't changed very much in the past 50 years. I find that a little depressing. And I'll talk a little bit about that and talk a little bit about what hopes I have for moving forward in the future with piston general aviation. But to give you an idea of what I'm talking about, if we look at the latest and greatest certificated aircraft that are being shipped new in 2018, like, for example, the Cirrus SR-22T is powered by a Continental engine, TSIO 520K, 550K, which, when you look at it, is really not very different than the TSIO 520 engines that power my 1979 Cessna 310. There are a few differences. The 550K in the Cirrus is a cross flow design with an induction system on top, whereas the engines in my Cessna 310 are updraft design. The Cirrus engines have intercoolers. The engines in my 310 do not. But really there aren't very many differences, and an awful lot of the parts are interchangeable between the two engines. Tim, are you having any problem with me? I'm getting an alert that says the internet connection may be bad. Are you having a problem?
No, I'm loud and clear with you, Mike. I got no other reports of any issues.
Okay, well, the alert just went away. I just wanted to check with you. Any rate, and both of these engines, the 550K that's in the Cirrus and the 520 that's in my old Cessna 310 are really second cousins and very closely related to the engine that powered my very first airplane, the 0470R Continental that powered my 1968 Skyline. There's a picture of my airplane that I bought new in 1968, picked up from the Cessna factory, and I'm glad to say that it's still on the FAA registry. It's somewhere in the Central Valley of California, and I hope it's been well taken care of since I sold it. But its engine is a very close cousin of those other two engines. There really have been only minor changes to those engines. And then if I look at Lycoming's, the Lycoming IO360 M1A in the latest new production Diamond DA40s is nearly identical to the Lycoming IO360 that powers the 1971 Cardinal RG that my book editor Colleen Keller flies. Those engines just haven't changed at all. When we take a look at when these engines were first certified, it's a little startling. The 0470 in my Skyline got its type certificate in 1952. That's 66 years ago. The engines that power my Cessna 310 got a type certificate 62 years ago. And even the engine that powers the brand new production Cirrus has a 38-year-old type certificate. The picture with Lycoming is similar. The 0360 carbureted engine got its type certificate in 1955, 63 years ago, and the IO360 in 1960, 58 years ago. When you think about that, these are ancient designs. Why aren't they in a museum instead of on new production airplanes? Why aren't they in a museum with some of these other nice engines that are in museums now? It just seems really strange that we are still getting brand new certificated airplanes powered by engines of literally Jurassic designs. The reason for that, of course, is that it's very, very difficult to certify a new engine and very expensive. And the process is so time-consuming and expensive and generally daunting that only companies with seriously deep pockets can pull it off. And even companies with seriously deep pockets, like Lycoming that is owned by Textron, or Continental that used to be owned by Teledyne and now by a very deep pocket Chinese firm, even these deep pocket firms haven't had real good luck when it comes to innovation. They've tried. They've tried from time to time. Does anybody remember this engine? This is the Continental Tiara engine, a 6285 engine. It received its type certificate in 1969. It was a clean sheet design with a lot of innovation. It was a fast turning, very light engine that actually drove the propeller off of a very beefy camshaft. So effectively it had a 2-to-1 reduction gear. A lot of very novel features on this engine. You can see it's a top induction design engine. Continental spent millions developing and certifying this engine from the ground up. This engine basically had no parts commonality with any other Continental engine. In fact, it has a top-mounted camshaft that, in a way, is more like a Lycoming than a Continental. Well, after spending all this money certifying this engine, it wound up on some Piper Pawnee ag plans and then quietly died. And unless you were around in the late 60s, you probably don't even remember this engine. But it was very novel, and it deserved a better fate than it had, but it wound up on the scrap heap because there was just no commercial interest in it. Little more recently, anybody remember this engine? This is an engine that Continental developed for Dick Rutan's around the world flight. It was a liquid cooled Continental four-cylinder engine. And because of the Voyager trip was such a high profile trip, Continental actually created a six-cylinder version of this engine, a TSIOL 520 and a TSIOL 550 liquid cooled engines. And there are just a handful of these engines flying, and it was a total commercial flop. And anybody who has an airplane with these engines on it, Ram had got an STC to put them on the Cessna 414. And there are a small handful of Cessna 414s flying around with these liquid cooled engines, and God help them if they need a cylinder. Because basically these engines are out of business and not really supported anymore. Lycoming developed the IO580 engine, developed it at the behest of Cessna to power their restart Cessna 206. They wanted the IO580 so that they could turn the prop slower and meet European noise standards by doing that. So they wanted a larger displacement engine that they could turn slower. But they wound up having so many problems with this engine during certification testing that ultimately Cessna abandoned the engine and wound up certifying the Cessna 206H with the IO540 engine. A very old design that got its type certificate in 1960. And the IO580 pretty much wound up on the scrap heap. It was a commercial failure. So there have been a number of attempts by these major manufacturers to innovate. The IO580 was a very minor innovation. The Tiara engine was a total clean sheet design. The Voyager engine was something in between. It was pretty much a standard Continental bottom end, but with liquid cooled cylinders of a novel design. And they haven't been very successful getting these things off the ground. And that tradition continues. I'll talk in a while about some new projects that haven't done too well either. What amazes me even more than the fact that we're flying with engines that have 60-year-old type certificates is the fact that we're still using, for the most part, in certificated engines anyway, we're using these old fixed-time mechanical magneto-ignition systems. It should have been relegated to the scrap heap a long time ago. The magneto was originally introduced in auto engines in 1897, if you believe it, by a fellow by the name of Robert Bosch, whose last name probably is familiar to many of you. And the magneto ignition system was developed back before cars had electrical systems. These magnetos gained popularity during the 20s and 30s in aircraft engines, and that was before airplanes had electrical systems. But ironically, the Bendix S1200 mags on my Cessna 310, I've got four of them, are for all intents and purposes identical to the ones that were produced in the Bendix Scintilla factory in 1935. Almost nothing about these magnetos has changed. It's very, very ancient technology. Just incredible that we're still using it. And it's even more incredible when you consider what's happened in the automotive world. The first electronic ignition systems, which were developed by Delco Remy in 1948. They were offered by Pontiac in 1963. These were distributors that used electronic ignition rather than coils and stuff. And the first completely solid state electronic ignition systems with microprocessor controls, variable timing, and all this stuff became pretty much standard in automobiles during the 1990s. In the experimental aircraft world, electronic ignition systems from EMAG and Lightspeed Engineering have been pretty much standard equipment on kit planes and LSAs for the past decade. The EMAG is interesting because it contains not only an electronic ignition system, but a built-in alternator. And although it runs off the aircraft's electrical system, if the electrical system fails, its own alternator picks up the slack. So it has all of the redundancy, you know, all of the electrical system independence of a magneto. And yet nothing like this is available for certified airplanes. And virtually all certified airplanes, new production certified airplanes, even though most of them nowadays are all electric airplanes with fully redundant electrical systems, dual alternators, dual batteries, dual buses, still have these old-fashioned fixed-time tractor mags that were, you know, developed in the 20s and 30s. And that I find that just really pretty puzzling. An interesting case study is the Electro-Air electronic ignition system. Electro-Air began working with the FAA in 2009 to obtain an STC to put its electronic ignition system on certificated 4 and 6 cylinder engines. And they were ultimately successful, but it took them 5 years to get this thing certified. And even then, after 5 years, the FAA would only approve replacing one magneto on the engine with the Electro-Air electronic ignition system. And the engine had to retain one of its old mechanical tractor mags, even though the magneto is demonstrably less reliable, far less reliable than the electronic system. But the FAA was not willing to approve a dual electronic ignition installations of this system on certificated engines, even though there were plenty of them flying on experimental engines. Going a step further from electronic ignition, we can talk about what's happened with FADEC controls of piston aircraft engines. In the late 90s, both Continental and Lycoming invested lots of money in FADEC. Lycoming developed something called the EPIC system in partnership with Unison. It never went anywhere and was abandoned. Continental acquired a company called Aerosance that had an electronic ignition system, a FADEC system. Very complicated system, by the way. They renamed it the PowerLink system, and they did get it certified. But it's only on a handful of engines, mostly flying on Liberty XL2 trainers that have a FADEC controlled engine, but almost, the system is almost unused other than on these Liberty trainers. So by any measure, it's been a colossal commercial failure. Never even came close to reaching critical mass. Continental still supports the PowerLink system. The Epic system is long since dead. Now, there have been some notable success stories, and the one that I find particularly uplifting is one that I've written about and done a webinar on, and that's the Rotax 912 series. Engine developed by a company that in Europe that was mostly known for engines on snowmobiles and jet skis and stuff like that. They had a series of aircraft, two-cycle aircraft engines that were used for, you know, powered hang gliders and that sort of thing. It had a reputation for not lasting very long and not being very reliable. But in the late 80s, they started working on a clean sheet design for a piston aircraft engine, four-stroke engine. In 89, they released an experimental version of the 912. It was an 80-horsepower engine. It had a very short TBO of 600 hours. It was mostly sold for European ultralights and motor gliders, and because of its very low horsepower rating and 600-hour TBO, it wasn't taken very seriously in the United States. In 1994, they managed to certify the engine, increased the TBO to 1,200 hours. In 1996, they came out with a 100-horsepower version. And they came out with a turbocharged 115-horsepower version with a 1,200-hour and 1,000-hour TBOs. Still, most people had never heard of this engine in the United States. It was better known in Europe. And that all that changed in 2004 when the FAA adopted the LSA rule, and all of a sudden, these factory-built SLSAs started showing up in the U.S., and the vast majority of them, more than 80% of them, were powered by Rotax 912s. Rotax introduced a version of the 912 called a ULS, specifically for SLSAs. They raised the TBO to 1,500 hours. And then in 2009, they increased the TBO on the 912 to 2,000 hours. And in 2010, they increased the one on the turbocharged engine, the 914, to 2,000 hours. In 2012, they came out with a version of this engine with fuel injection, a full FADEC. And then in 2017, they launched the 915 IS, which was a turbocharged version. Again, full FADEC engine, turbocharged, and 135 horsepower output. These engines are what they were competing with, were the old, in this 100 horsepower-ish range, were the Continental 0200 and the Lycoming 0235. And the Rotax beat those engines in every possible way. It was just a remarkable breakthrough engine when you compared it to the old-fashioned competition. It was smaller, it's lighter, much lighter, more fuel efficient, and it was designed to run on unleaded MoGas, which reduced fuel cost. So it had just a ton of advantages, which is why almost all the SLSA manufacturers went with this engine. The way Rotax did it was a bunch of things. They turn the engine real fast, which allows them to use a very small displacement, which allows them to make the engine very light. The engine incorporates a 2-to-1 reduction gearbox so that the prop turns at a nice reasonable speed, 2,500 RPM or so, while a crankshaft is turning at 5,000. They liquid cool the cylinder heads. The earlier versions used an electronic ignition system. The later versions used a full FADEC. They built integral dual alternators right inside the engine so that the engine was self-powering and didn't depend on any external component, electrical system components. And the engine, over time, evolved to have a 2,000-hour TBO, which is fully competitive with the older designs. So it was it's a tremendous engine. And I've talked to the guys that overhaul them, and they say when they tear them apart at 5,000 or 2,000 hours, they look almost brand new inside. It's just an outstanding design, and I only wish that Rotax would get interested in making a bigger engine that could go on higher performance and larger aircraft. I'm told that they actually developed a design for a 200 horsepower engine, and that Lycoming bought the rights, the exclusive rights to that engine, and buried it in a hole in the ground. There are some other novel engine designs that are in development and that are somewhat hopeful, and most of them are compression ignition engines, diesel engines, that are designed to run on Jet A. That's going to be huge because Jet A is a lot cheaper and much more widely available throughout the world than avgas. There are a lot of places in the world where you can't get avgas, and there are a lot of places in the world where you can get avgas, but it's unspeakably expensive. So diesel engines, I think, are represent the best hope for the future of piston general aviation. But the diesel engines have had a pretty rocky start. In 2013, Cessna made a huge splash when it announced that it was producing a new version of the Cessna 182 that was dubbed the Skylane JTA with an SMA turbo diesel engine from France. They spent a lot of money getting this thing certified. They had a bunch of customer orders, and literally on the eve of first customer deliveries, Cessna canceled the program. They never said why they canceled the program, but we think it had something to do with some turbocharger issues with the engine that they got in trouble with the FAA on. We're not really sure what happened there, but at any rate, the program got canceled, and it was a big disappointment to me because I thought that this diesel-powered Skylane was the best chance we had of getting GA diesel engines on the map in some significant quantity. In Germany, Thielert developed a line of diesel aircraft engines called the Centurion line that borrowed heavily from Mercedes-Benz automotive diesels. Diamond adopted this engine for use on their DA42 twin. It was a pretty attractive engine, although it had some gearbox issues, but then Thielert went bankrupt in a big scandal. Ultimately, China's AVIC conglomerate acquired the rights to these engines. AVIC is the same firm that owns Continental Motors. And they after a period of time, they resurrected these Centurion engines via a German subsidiary of AVIC called Technify Motors. So they're built in Germany, and they're now being marketed by Continental Motors, which is also an AVIC-owned company. Whether or not these things are going to get to critical mass is not yet clear, although they have a chance. In 2014, Piper started shipping a version of the Archer called the Archer DX that's powered by one of these Centurion engines, the Centurion 155, which is a 155 horsepower version of the Centurion engine. And just recently, Piper announced that it would produce a twin engine Piper Seminole DX that had a pair of CD 170 diesels, again, Centurion diesels from Technify. We'll see if the Seminole comes to fruition or whether somehow it gets canceled the way the Cessna Skylane JTA did. But, you know, I'm hopeful. Diamond, as I mentioned, used the Tielert engine on their DA-42 Twin Star, and then when Tielert went bankrupt, they were in, they basically were stuck without an engine, and the owners of the Tielert powered engines were really stuck because they had engines that weren't supported anymore. It was a bad situation, but after about a year or so, Diamond restarted production on the DA-42 using a new diesel engine built by its own subsidiary in Austria, a company called Austro Engine. And that's what they're now delivering on diesel-powered DA-42s, is this AE300 diesel that's built by a Diamond subsidiary in Austria. Cessna did it again. They announced that they would make a Skyhawk JTA, this one powered by a Centurion CD-155 engine, and then recently announced that it was canceling the program before any aircraft were delivered. So just because a manufacturer announces that they're doing something doesn't mean it's going to happen. We just have to keep watching and hoping. Meanwhile, a couple of things that I'm keeping my eye on. There are two small startup companies in Wisconsin called Delta Hawk Engines and Engineered Propulsion Systems that are working to achieve FAA certification on new clean sheet design diesel engines. Two very, very different engines. The Delta Hawk engine is a lightweight, compact, 180 horsepower, two-stroke turbo diesel that's aimed as a replacement for 360 series Lycomings and Continentals. So it's competing for the sort of the small end of the piston engine space. The EPS engine, called a Graphlite V8, is a big, giant, 350 horsepower engine, V8 engine, that's aimed at high performance singles and twins. And so we'll just have to see how that goes. It's really hard for small companies like this to stay alive long enough to get certification on these engines, because it's very expensive. So it's still too early to tell whether any of these diesels are going to reach critical mass to be commercially successful. But I've got my fingers crossed, because I think diesels are the best hope we have for a robust piston GA going forward. Now, there are a couple of things I find encouraging, although most of us are still flying behind these Jurassic engine designs with these fixed time magnetos. There have been some major changes in the way we operate and maintain these power plants over the last 50 years. And those changes have been for the better. We've learned a lot about the right way to do things. And the word is starting to get out. And aircraft owners are doing a better job of operating and maintaining these power plants than they used to. We're operating the engines much more efficiently. We're running them over square using high manifold pressure and low RPM, something that my flight instructor told me never ever to do because it would blow up the engine. It turns out that that's not right. It's the best thing you can do. I'm going to be doing a webinar in a couple months on this particular subject of running over square. But it's absolutely the best way to run these engines. More and more of us are cruising Lena Peak instead of Richa Peak, which is not only very good for fuel economy, but it's very good for engine longevity. It's the best thing you can do to get long life out of the engine. And I've done several webinars on the subject of leaning. And we're taking steps to improve the mixture distribution of our engines by putting in tuned injectors and stuff so that we can run the engines much leaner than we used to without unacceptable roughness. So all of these operational things are good. It's taken a long time from, George Brawley started preaching lean a peak operation about 20 years ago. And it's taken that long for his teachings to have been widely accepted. And there are still a lot of people who are scared to operate Richa Peak, and manufacturers are tend not to recommend it, but it is absolutely the best way to run the engines, and eventually the community will catch up. But we've made big strides now. And in certain owner communities, like, for example, Cirrus's and so on, virtually every owner operates at Lena Peak because the word's getting out. In the area of maintenance, we're starting more and more to use reliability-centered maintenance approach to things rather than the old way of doing things. And I've been preaching this now, again, for about 20 years. And gradually starting to have an impact, where more and more of us are overhauling engines on condition rather than at a fixed TBO. We're doing less invasive maintenance. We're more reluctant to pull cylinders, and we do more things to prevent taking things apart when we don't have to. And we're using things like borescopes and engine monitors to monitor the condition of the engine better and know when something needs to be done to it. So these are all, I think, big steps forward that I find very encouraging. But these things, the operational things and the maintenance things, it's the aircraft owners that are leading the charge on these things, not the manufacturers or the mechanics, because aircraft owners tend to be more willing to accept new ideas and to try new things than the industry tends to be. And so at any rate, that's kind of my view of what's been happening. Some of it kind of depressing, some of it encouraging. But we have to keep pressing forward and try to get to the point where we're flying behind modern technology engines. It's a real struggle to do that in this industry. And Tim, that's all the prepared material I have, but I'd be happy to open things up for discussion.
Okay, Mike, thank you so much. We do have some questions that have come in already, so let's just start right off.
Gregory is wondering, will the replacement fuel for 100 low lead cause any changes to engine design?
Well, it's not supposed to. And that's part of what this whole program that's going on with the FAA in Atlantic City that's now been pushed back a year is supposed to ensure. They're doing extensive compatibility testing in a wide variety of aircraft. And they're not only testing the replacement fuels, but they're testing all sorts of mixtures of replacement fuels with 100 low lead, because they realize that once unleaded avgas is approved, it's going to take years before it becomes widely available at all of our airports. So for a period of years, we're going to be having to operate on a mixture of the new fuel and the old fuel. And so the big part of what they're doing is making sure that that any mixture of new fuel and 100 low lead will work okay, will be compatible with O-rings and bladders and hoses and all of the stuff that they're worrying about. And in fact, they have run into some issues and sent both Shell and Swift back to the drawing boards. And that's why they recently announced that they're moving their target end date on this program a year later. It was supposed to, the program was supposed to be completed by the end of 2018, and now they're projecting is be completed by the end of 2019.
Walt's wondering, how much of an engine can change without it needing to be recertified? For example, a modern ignition system would improve performance a lot.
Well, any significant change needs to be of a certificated engine needs to be FAA approved, but the smaller the change, the easier the approval. If you make a big change, then you wind up having to go through 600 hour endurance tests and stuff that's fairly expensive to do. If you make small changes, then typically the FAA will accept just localized testing of the, let's say you're changing to a different starter motor or something like that. That tends to be much, much easier to accomplish. Because the change is only to one component. And in the case of a starter motor, as long as you can demonstrate that this starter can't cause an engine failure in flight, it wouldn't be that hard to get the FAA to approve it. But it varies all over the place, depending on what kind of modifications being made. The certification costs may be extensive or not. The other thing that serves as a big break on innovation, and I've talked about this in previous webinars, is the extreme fear of litigation that the industry has. There's this mindset that anytime you introduce an improvement to a product, you're admitting that your previous product wasn't as good as it could have been. And you open yourself up for the possibility of being sued over that. So it's not only the FAA that serves as a big flywheel on innovation, but it's also the fear of litigation that makes manufacturers reluctant to consider some sorts of improvements to their products.
So that pretty much answers Walt's question here. He says, is the FAA the sole reason new engine designs have not been introduced?
Yeah, I think the FAA and fear of litigation, and also, you know, frankly, there have been some cases of bad timing. you know, there was a bunch of stuff that was done, work that was started in the, you know, the early 80s that came to fruition just as the general aviation industry was in free fall. And I don't care what kind of a great idea you had back then. It wasn't going to get on any new airplanes because there weren't any new airplanes being sold. And, you know, the industry has been slowly climbing back. But it's never going to, it's probably never going to reach the rates of production and so on that we saw in the late 70s and early 80s, which was kind of the peak of GA production. And a big part of the reason is that the tax structure has changed. Back during those times, late 70s and early 80s, GA was being buoyed on a whole series of tax loopholes that, you know, double declining balance depreciation and investment tax credits and all sorts of stuff that were really designed to incentivize people to buy, you know, new lathes and drill presses, but actually were being used to incentivize people to buy new airplanes and boats and luxury cars. And then, you know, in the early 80s, all of those tax loopholes were eliminated during the Reagan administration. And it that was the right thing to do, but it was devastating. It had a devastating effect on GA. And we've not recovered from it.
Greg's asking, if the Tiara engine was certified, why didn't any manufacturer use it enough to make it in the market?
I don't know the answer to that. It was certified. It got its type certificate in 1969. So it should have benefited from the GA boom of the 70s. And for some reason it didn't. And I really don't know why. I just know that it got into the Piper Pawnee ag plane. It got into some small four-place British trainer. And then it just went nowhere. And I don't know why. I never heard that there were, you know, technical problems with the engine. For some reason, it just was not adopted by, they just weren't any takers.
David is wondering, seems like new engine technology is there, but seems to fail commercially. He's wondering why. His observation would be excessive cost to the consumer who will not pay the extreme price to move forward.
Well, you know, there's probably a lot of truth in that. And when was it? A month or two ago, I did the Planes and Cars webinar where I compared the cost of a new Skylane with a new Cadillac in 1968 when I bought my Skylane, and the comparison now. And it used to be that you could buy a Skylane for the price of four Cadillacs, and now it's more like 14 Cadillacs. I mean, the price of GA airplanes has gotten totally out of control, which is why so few people can afford them and why so many people are going the EAV route, because certificated airplanes have just become new certificated airplanes have just become unaffordable.
Dave is wondering if you had any thoughts on the DA-40NG power plant reliability and longevity.
I don't have any exposure to that, so I don't have any thoughts on it.
Robert is wondering, what are the qualifications of the personnel at the FAA who are responsible for engineering approval for new aircraft engines?
Well, that's been another problem traditionally, because I've done a lot of work with those guys, and to be honest with you, and I don't want to offend anybody who's listening to this webinar, but the FAA engine people are mostly turbine engine guys. There aren't a lot of people, particularly at the aircraft certification offices where a lot of this work is done, that know very much about piston engines. And so they're, in many cases, they're kind of flying blind on this stuff.
Okay, question about power speed reduction units, gearboxes. Donald's wondering, are the power speed reduction units reliable on the engines using them? The PSRU seems to be the weak link in auto engine conversions.
Well, you know, it depends. The gearbox was a gigantic problem for the Thieler diesel. It was a disaster, really. And they wound up having to tear it apart every few hundred hours. The gearbox on the Rotax 912, by all accounts, is basically trouble-free. All they ask for is a 1,000-hour inspection. And as long as you're using MoGas in the 912, which is what it was designed to run on, the gearboxes don't seem to give any problems. If you're running 100 low lead, there have been some problems with lead sludge deposit in the gearbox and also lead sludge buildup in the oil tank and a bunch of other things. The engine really doesn't, it's approved for running on 100 low lead, but it really doesn't like to do that. But it seems to be a very reliable gearbox. On the other hand, the one in the Thieler diesel was very, very problematic. Of course, if you think about it, the diesels have much more severe power pulses than spark ignition engines, because effectively a diesel is an engine that's running constantly in a state of detonation. And so, for example, nobody's been able to keep a metal prop on a diesel engine because the pulses, the power pulses to the prop cause fatigue failures. And so all the diesel engines are running composite props. And that might have a lot to do with the longevity of the gearbox, because it's, I mean, I'm not an aeronautical engineer, but it's pretty obvious that the gearbox of a diesel engine is putting up with a lot more of a challenge than the gearbox in a spark ignition engine. It'll be interesting to see how the gearboxes fare on these Centurion engines, which are basically the old Thieler engine that's been resurrected by AVIC. They've apparently made a whole bunch of improvements to the gearbox and beefed it up, but only time in the field will tell how those things are working out.
Stephen is wondering, why do many, if not most, American pilots dislike or even hate the Rotax engine? The 915IS, in my opinion, is a game changer.
I've never spoken to anybody that owns a 912 powered airplane that doesn't love the engine. I don't know who he's talking about who hates the engine, but there are probably people who don't know very much about it, because it is absolutely a game changing engine. And, you know, pretty much everything about it is good and a big step forward from the Lycoming Continental engine technology. It's a very, very well done engine.
Patrick is wondering, Mike, great as usual, what can an owner do with regard to getting rid of mags? Is experimental the only option?
Well, like I say, Electro Air has certified its electronic ignition system on almost all certified piston engines now, like Home and Continental engines. And the only hitch is that you could only replace one of the mags. So you lose a little of an advantage of having the two spark plugs firing at the same time. If you put the electrowear system on the engine at, reduced manifold pressures up in cruise, the electrowear advances the spark timing, which provides for more efficient operation, fuel savings, all kinds of good things, but only advances the spark timing on one spark plug. So the mag fired spark plug is going off at its fixed timing, which by the time it goes off, almost all the exciting stuff has happened. So it's almost like a wasted spark when you're in higher altitude cruise with the electrowear system. But you know, it's a good system. It just could be a great system if the FAA would allow both mags to be replaced. But at present they don't, and I don't know what it would take for them to change their position on that.
Yeah. So David's question is, the single electrowear system worthwhile? Is it worth doing? He's asking.
I think it is. The only reason I don't have it on my airplane is because it's not presently certified for turbocharged aircraft. I talked to the electrowear guys about that. But at present, it's not something that's available. But I would put it on my airplane if it was approved for my turbocharged engines. I do think it's definitely a good thing.
Victor's wondering, is the more recent FADEC engine failures due to high cost or high complexity?
Well, I don't know what FADEC engine failures he's referring to. I know there was a famous failure of a Diamond DA-42 that had a double engine shutdown due to the fact that the airplane had a fully redundant electrical system, and the pilot did something he wasn't allowed to do. As a result, he had a complete electrical system failure, and the electrical system failure shut down the FADEC. There was an emergency AD. The emergency AD basically cured the problem by adding some diesel alkaline batteries as a backup power source for the FADEC, so that this could never happen again. And I'm not really aware of, since that happened, of any FADEC failures that have gotten on my radar screen.
Walt's wondering, are STC engine upgrades the only option to modernize certified engines?
Well, I don't really understand the question. I mean, there are only two possibilities. One is that the aircraft manufacturer adopts the new engine and starts delivering aircraft with it, like, for example, Piper with its Archer DX. And the other is that you convert an existing aircraft using an STC. But those are the only two ways to do it, as far as I know.
Wayne's wondering, if you were building experimental, would you use two electronic ignitions? Because some recommend one mag with one electronic ignition.
They probably work for the FAA. No, that's a joke. Of course, I'd put dual electronic ignitions, absolutely, without question. But I would need to make absolutely sure that there was sufficient redundancy in terms of power source to make sure that those things would keep the engine turning, even if I had an electrical problem. Now, that's one of the big advantages of something like the EMAG, because it's self-powered. Just like a mag is. The other systems rely on some sort of backup, but it can be, you know, as the DA-42 example shows, it can be as simple as putting some alkaline batteries in there for as an emergency power supply for the system. But you know, that's if you're going to dual electronic systems, you just have to make sure that it doesn't run out of juice. And there's lots of ways to skin that cat. But as an experimental builder, you'd be responsible for figuring out something that was sufficiently reliable to meet your criteria.
Mm-hmm. And Neil's wondering, what advantages are there in using electronic ignition?
Well, I mean, there are a number of advantages. The biggest advantage is variable ignition timing. That the spark timing can be advanced at lower power settings or at leaner mixture settings, and retarded, you know, for full takeoff power. Whereas with magnetos, we're stuck with fixed time. I mean, even the 1947 Plymouth that I learned to drive in, man, I'm dating myself now, you know, had a vacuum advance on the distributor so that it had variable timing. And it's absolutely insanity that our aircraft engines have fixed ignition timing. So that's one of the big advantages of electronic ignition, is that it can vary the timing. Second advantage is that it tends to have a much hotter spark. It's a capacitive discharge kind of spark that produces a much more intense spark than mags do. Typically, the electronic ignition systems don't use aviation spark plugs. They use automotive spark plugs because they need a bigger gap because they fire such a hotter spark. And the aviation spark plugs don't allow gaps to be that big. I think those are the two biggest things is variable timing and a hotter spark. And then the third thing is simply the electronic system should be much, much more reliable because it doesn't have any moving parts, doesn't have plastic gears that can shed teeth. It's solid state. So it should be vastly more reliable than mechanical mags. And we have lots of mag problems. They're pretty troublesome devices.
Greg's wondering, will the FAA put engine certification through the same rewrite process like they did with Part 23?
Well, I don't know. The Part 23 rewrite obviously doesn't affect engine certification, which is under Part 33. In my talks with the Engine Propeller Directorate, or the organization that used to be known as the Engine Propeller Directorate because they reorganized now, but those guys would like to do something like Part 33, like Part 23. They would like to move into a world where it's more consensus standards and where the FAA is in a less prescriptive mode. And a perfect example of this is what they're doing with electric propulsion, because they're not writing certification regs for electric propulsion. They're participating in the with the industry standard groups, and will be endorsing the standards that come out of that. So they want to, in their heart, they want to do something for engines more or less along the lines of what they've done in Part 33, or Part 23 rewrite. Whether the regs actually get changed that way, that remains to be seen, because changing regulations is a very, very long and expensive and complicated and slow process. But I think there's a general sense among those people that's the way they would like to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it leads into James' comment. Given the advantages of FADEC and the new mindset of FAA towards faster approval of safety enhancements, When do you think we'll see FADEC retrofit kits for legacy engines?
Oh, boy. That's a good question. I mean, I don't really know of any good candidates for that. I don't think, you know, the Lycoming system is not going to get resurrected. The Continental system is not, they're not interested in the retrofit market. That's a pretty big mouthful to bite off. I suspect that once the FAA gets a little bit more comfortable with electronic ignition retrofits, maybe it'll be time to start thinking about FADEC retrofits, which is electronic ignition plus fuel control, all controlled by computers. But that's a step beyond, and we're still having problems with the FAA on simple electronic ignition systems. So I don't see that happening anytime real soon.
Unfortunate. Yeah. Ken's wondering, what are your thoughts on the Lycoming IE2 electronic engine, especially with the Technam Traveler nearing certification?
Again, I'm not familiar with it, so I need to plead the fifth. An awful lot of what I've talked about makes an awfully strong argument for going EAB, doesn't it?
Yeah, right. Well, and that feeds into Mike's question. Mike says, I have an experimental RV10 with slick mags due for the 500 hour. Rather than service the mags, would you recommend switching to EMAG? Which one should I consider?
I would absolutely consider switching to EMAG. And I'd have to pull up their website to give you a model number, but they're very commonly used. I forget what engine you said you had, but it was an RV?
RV10, which is the big four-seater. So he's got probably the big, 540 in there. I'm not sure, but I think the 540 they put in there.
Well, I know that there's six-cylinder versions of the EMAG, and I'm sure that they would work on that engine. And I think that would be very worthwhile to consider.
IO 540, he said. Yeah, he's got the IO 540. Yeah, so why rebuild that old technology? Just replace it with some new technology as well. In other words, the message
you need to price it out first, but it does seem to me, if it's a experimental, I don't know why you would want to hang on to those old tractor mags. I wouldn't.
That's the reason for EAB, that's for sure. Use new technologies, yeah. Hey, George is wondering, you said one engine had a cam-driven prop. This sounds like a good way to run a high RPM lighter engine without a reduction unit.
Well, it is a reduction unit, in effect. That what they did was, they just beefed up the crankshaft gear and the camshaft gear like crazy so that instead of just driving a camshaft, it would drive a camshaft plus a propeller. But of course it is a reduction unit, but every engine has a reduction unit for the cam. This just put it on steroids so it could drive a prop.
Yeah. Yeah.
The camshaft becomes a big beefy structural member because it's driving the main load out there. But it's a pretty clever idea, I think.
So George's question is, I wonder why we don't see more engines like this.
Well, I think I answered that.
Yeah, we're kind of beating a dead horse on this one a little bit.
Yeah.
Hey, we've had a lot of people find interest in your lean of peak your comments you made.
Over square, Walt says thumbs up on running over squared. He's got an E225 Continental. He says less maintenance issues and minimum of 1.25 gallon per hour decrease in fuel consumption. Beautiful. Yep. Bore scopes at annual.
Yep. I've actually prepared a PowerPoint presentation that I'll be doing as a webinar coming up. It's actually on my next slide or something. But yeah, I'm planning to do that.
So you're going to have I
previewed this one last Friday at a pilot's group here in Santa Barbara, and it was very well received. So I decided I would foist it on the entire EAA webinar community.
Hey, it's not a waste. It's a treat. Thank you. So you're going to answer John's question, which is why is running over square better? So you're going to answer that in an upcoming webinar in a couple of months.
I will in exhaustive detail.
That's awesome. So we've had some other people ask about running lean of peak. Now, are the two the same?
No, they're quite independent. Yeah. Although running over square, I'll put it another way, running at low RPMs is especially important when you're running lean of peak. But it's a good idea regardless of whether you're running rigid peak or lean of peak. It just becomes even more important if you're running lean of peak. And that's a long discussion and needs some charts and graphs and stuff. And so I'll be doing that. Stay tuned, folks. Fantastic. Be doing the webinar on that.
That'll be a good one. I know several years ago, I guess you did, lean of peak webinars, a couple different of them. And those were, I know, very well received. People loved those. Good webinar presentations in the archives there. Well, I think most of the questions that are unique have been asked. We got a lot of questions kind of repeating that same theme. That we've kind of touched on already. So let's wrap it up here, Mike. Please go ahead and share your closing comments with everybody. My counter showed probably close to 500 people logged in tonight.
Cool. Well, not much to say. The usual sign up for my e-newsletter, monthly newsletter at savvyaviation.com, or check the checkbox on the post webinar survey that Tim is going to put up. He'd appreciate it if you'd hang around and fill out the survey. And there's a checkbox on the survey if you want to get on the mailing list. My two books, including my new engines book, are available at Amazon. It was pretty cool. They EAA ordered a bunch of the books. Aircraft Spruce ordered a bunch of the books to have up at Air Venture. Mm-hmm. And by midday Wednesday, they were all sold out.
Awesome.
they didn't order enough. So that was cool. I like that. But anyway, it's the response to the book has been tremendous. It's so it's available on Amazon. Both of the books are available on Amazon. And finally, the upcoming webinars for September, October, November. September, inside the crankcase, we'll be talking about the bottom end of the engine, the part that you normally don't get to see. October, we'll be talking about turbocharging systems, and November, the much anticipated operating over square. So that's all I have, Tim.
Well, thank you so much, Mike. Really do appreciate you being part of the webinar series here. Each month, over all these years, your contributions are just exceptional. Hard to describe the value that you're giving us and all the people who are tuned in. Thank you so much. And I know that you just returned home from being here in Oshkosh at AirVenture. And I think I saw on your schedule you did 12 forums, so 12 live.
No. You're grossly exaggerating. It was only 11.
Only 11. Okay.
Only 11. Oh, that's because I had to take Thursday off because I was involved with the General Aviation Awards program.
Thank you so much. I don't know how your voice can do it. I know I do about one. I think I did four or five during the week. And by the end of the week, my voice is just raw.
It's very energizing, you know. This year was, the weather was so great that it was hard not to be energized.
Yeah. It was a good year, as they say.
Yep.
Well, very good, Mike. Thank you so much. And to everybody who tuned in tonight, all over 500 of you, thank you all so much for tuning in. Truly do appreciate you joining us tonight, and have a wonderful evening. Hope you can join us next week. We're going to be talking about home-built gliders and all the many years of home-built gliders, over 164 years worth of home-building gliders. So should be interesting. Murray Rosinski from the Soaring Society of America will be talking to us next week. Have a wonderful evening, everybody.
Thanks, everybody. See you next month.